bus in zones 4, 2, 9.
Please mind the step when boarding this track. And be aware, this platform does not have tactile paving at the edge.
Their loved ones, As Angela has touched on, the raids claimed 94 lives, destroying a third of York's housing and damaging historical sites across the city, including where we stand now, York Station. Taking the lives of the two railway workers, William Milner and Robert Smith. And all of our thoughts and prayers are with those who lost their lives. On that night, York Station was deliberately targeted. It was the main target of the raid because of the role it played during the Second World War and its principal location and role on the railway network. Near to where we're standing now, a high explosive bomb hit the station, demolishing one of the cast iron roof columns and damaging several arch ribs, causing significant destruction and damage. The events of the 29th of April 1942 were tragic, and the city as a whole suffered immeasurably that day. People and communities devastated by the raid. But York's response to the bombing that morning is one of strength, bravery, courage and resilience. And the efforts of the railway workers that day in response to the bombing is immensely powerful and exhibits everything that the railway family is all about. Just a couple of words about William and Robert. So William Milner was a station foreman, and his story is one of those inspiring stories. He lost his life after entering a burning building, burning because of the raid, and he went in to obtain a box of medical supplies so that other people could be treated. He lost his life, and he was posthumously awarded the King's Commendation for gallantry. Railway policeman Robert Smith was also killed in the raid. We're going to hear a bit more about Robert, but then the plaque that we're unveiling today on the 18th anniversary is being placed close to where Robert Smith died. We pay tribute to both men and reflect on their bravery as well as the bravery of their colleagues on that day. Others played their part. Bravery, courage and quick thinking by railway workers saved other lives. At 10:15 p.m, King's Cross to Edinburgh train, standing at what is now Platform 5, just across the tracks, called fire, destroying six coaches. However, the efforts of those at the station, including assistant station manager Mr. Lyon, allowed 14 of the 20 carriages in the train to be rescued. Signalman Simpson deployed swift thinking, and he helped secure 20 burning wagons of a parcel train that had caught fire due to the rains. Within the station, station porters worked together to kick incendiaries off the platforms, and booking office staff dragged burning furniture from the waiting rooms out of harm's way. And illustrating perhaps just how much the railway has changed, stableman Alfred Martin, van setter H. Craig and police constable A. Asquith rescued 19 horses from the bombed railway stables. These are just some of the immediate and collective efforts of everyone at York Station that day. Incredible examples of strength and resilience.
I'd like to read a poem for you today, The Final Inspection. The policeman stood and faced his God, which must always come to pass. He hoped his shoes were shining just as brightly as his brass. Step forward now, policeman, how shall I deal with you? Have you always turned the other cheek? To my church have you been true? The policeman squared his shoulders, and no, Lord, I guess I ain't, because those of us who carry badges can't always be a saint. I've had to work most Sundays, and at times my talk was rough, and sometimes I've been violent because the streets are awfully tough. But I never took a penny that wasn't mine to keep, though I worked a lot of overtime when the bills got just too steep. And I never passed a cry for help, though at times I shook with fear. And sometimes, God forgive me, I've wept unmanly tears. I know I don't deserve a place among the people here. They never wanted me around, except to calm their fear. Step forward now, policeman, you've borne your burdens well. Come walk a beat on heaven's streets, you've done your time in hell. Thank you.
Sources and data sets that become available. We know that he started working for the North Eastern Railway back in 1919 as a messenger boy. And by 1921, he was a goods porter, and on the 1939 register, he was a heavy goods porter, and of course, as we know, station foreman. So to redress the balance, I'm going to give a bit more on the life of Robert William Smith. Robert William Smith was born in Givendale, east of York, on the 17th of July, 1877. So he was the same age as this railway station. The eldest of five children, he worked as a farm servant in Kirby-under-Dale until his marriage to Emily Pedder in 1900 at Yappin, when his new job as a railway police constable took him to Hull, where he set up his home. By 1911, he was living in Greek Street, Hull, which isn't far from the railway station, on the approaches to the station itself. By then, he had a wife and two daughters. On the 1921 census, he had moved back to York, again working as a railway policeman with the North Eastern Railway, and then, of course, after 1923, the London North Eastern Railway. He moved in with his wife and two daughters to 34 Kensington Street in South Bank, where he remained until his death. In 1921, his eldest daughter, Elsie, died aged only 18. His younger daughter, Gladys May, born in 1903, was born blind and never married, so he has no living descendants. On the 1939 register, he was still at 34 Kensington Street and an L&ER policeman. And this is where it gets a bit foggy, because on the 1939 register, taken by an enumerator, his job was given as York Water Works Company Railway Policeman. Now, the old railway hands will know, when we say Water Works in York, we mean just to the north, Water Works Crossing. That was his patch. At the time of the death, therefore, he was 64 years old. Why was his grave overgrown and forgotten? His brother Lewis Smith was in Fanfoss, his brother Harold Basement Smith was in Uplington. Is it because his brothers remained in farming when Robert went to work for the railway police? Robert's widow Emily died at 34 Kensington Street in 1950, so the only survivor in his immediate family was his blind daughter Gladys, who lasted until 1980, living alone. There was no money for a headstone and no family base locally to tend the grave. So, like many, so many, he was forgotten. Most family historians balk at the surname Smith. Like Beecher's Brook, when you feel the name Smith in the family tree, you feel a lurch. But Robert's uniqueness is that he was a railway policeman. So unlike his family who stayed in farmer, they stayed in farming, that was his career, and he stuck with it. Here, the employment by the Army as a policeman gave him eternal knowledge as a firm. It's a job he performed to the end. He kept watch. Do we owe it to him to do likewise? Thank you.
It was written by a paratrooper who landed at Pegasus Bridge. They call him the veteran. They ask us why we do it. Why we still parade. Now we are getting older and just a little frayed. It's not for the sake of glory or the medals on our chests. It's simply we are comrades who stood the final test. On the 6th of June, that fateful day, a day we will never forget, many a lad laid down his life and paid the final debt. So when you see a veteran, give the man your hand, for those medals on his chest were won in a foreign land. And when God asks the question, who are you, my man? I will proudly answer, sir, I am a veteran.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
09 Northern Service to Leeds. Ordered Micklefield, East Garforth, Garforth, Crossgates and Leeds.
Thank you. going straight for it.
Yeah, that's two.
Zones 10 and 5. Standard class in zones 9 to 6.